Hello, everyone. We're starting with an introduction and overview over data quality. What do we mean by that? Why is it an issue and why is it important? I'd like to start with a comic from the Dilbert series. If you don't know that, Dilbert is a series about the everyday life of a software developer and enterprise in the enterprise world. It's often a bit cynical, but there's also a lot of truth to that. And that's a comic about data quality. So take a minute to look at it. Now, the gist of this comic strip is that if you have data that is wrong, it's really hard to make decisions. And there's also not a lot of things that you can do. If you don't know what data is wrong and what data is not wrong, and if you don't know what errors there are in the data, it also doesn't help to apply some arbitrary operations to that data. So the first question here is, why is data quality important? And data quality is important on many levels for organizations and companies. First of all, that might be the most obvious issue. Companies and organizations are trying to make decisions based on data. So if you have missing or incorrect data, then this can obviously lead to wrong decisions. You would have made other decisions if you had the real data. Other than that, especially for the enterprise world, there's also a lot of legal obligations in certain business scenarios, for example. One practice that I know from my job working at e-commerce companies is that, for example, if you want to sell electric devices in the European Union, then you need to have a very exact information about the plug types of these devices, because there's simply regulations that you can only sell certain things if they are compatible with the electricity system in some countries in the EU. Then there is another area of data quality which has only been discovered in the last years and which is gaining more and more attention, and that is the connection between data quality and machine learning models. So data quality can also have an impact on machine learning models that are trained on the data. And in general, if you have cleaner data, it's easier to train a model on that data. And empirically, in many cases, it has been found that actually cleaning the data was a factor that greatly improved the model performance, sometimes much more than just tuning hyperparameters, for example. And another area that's not in the focus of this course, but there's a lot of research, and Uwe also offers now a course about that. Another area is about the fairness, accountability, and transparency of machine learning-based systems, because it has been found that machine learning models and their decisions can reproduce and maybe amplify discrimination that's happening. One example is that it has been often encountered that face recognition systems don't work as well for people with darker skin than for people with lighter skin. And there is also a data quality issue here, because it might be that the training data of a certain group of persons has maybe more errors or more quality issues. For whatever reason, and as a result, it might be the case that the models don't work as well for this group. So this area is, I think, it's very important, but at the moment it's not well understood, and it's an active area of research. And there's another aspect of data quality which is often ignored, I think simply because a lot of people are not aware of this connection, and that is what I call here operational stability. So we have systems that consume data, that act based on this data, that compute new data based on the input data. And data quality issues can not only lead to wrong results, data quality issues can also lead to crashes, for example. That's also something that I learned during my time in industry. So for example, in Java, there are these so-called null pointer exceptions. That means Java expects an object to exist, but there's only a null pointer, and then your system crashes because it cannot invoke a method on that object. And for example, if you have missing values in your data, it can be very easy for your Java program to produce these null pointer exceptions that crash your systems. And the other thing, which I already mentioned, is of course there can be wrong predictions. Let's say you compute something based on a time that's measured in minutes, and somebody accidentally puts the time in seconds there. So immediately the scale of the result also changes, and that can have devastating consequences. And in general, I find it very difficult to study this problem in academia, because very often in academic research, maybe also in your data science classes, we work with data sets that are not really representative of the data in the real world. So there's a bunch of common data sets that people often use for benchmarks and for examples. And often these data sets are static. So somebody collected them at some point in time, then everybody's using the same version. And often these data sets are already downsampled, cleaned, and aggregated before they have been published. So it's not the original data that some company or some research group might have gathered. Often they make sure that maybe only the nice cases or only a certain type of cases appear in the data. And in general, usually the attributes of the data are rather well understood. So there's some documentation, a lot of people work with this data already. So it's easy to figure out what the data means. And from a technical perspective, most of the time these data sets have a size that is convenient for processing on desktop machines, because maybe you want to do experiments with it, or you want to do class homework with it. So you couldn't take some really huge data set where it takes ages to test something there. And an example for this are the UCI machine learning data sets. I don't know if you know that, but there's a very large collection of data sets from machine learning research that are used in many important research papers. But I think in many cases, we cannot assume that these data sets are really representative of real world data. So what changes once we go to real-world data? Well, I think the most important thing is that in real-world data is constantly changing. So I don't know, if you have a web shop, for example, then you will always have new products that you have to sell. There's always new users joining your website. there's lots of interactions going on. So nothing is static. Also, in the real world, if you look into the databases and data warehouses, you very often, it's really surprising, but you often have tables or data sets with hundreds of attributes. And in more cases than you would think, people don't really know what these attributes mean, or maybe these attributes mean different things for different parts of the data, or maybe their meaning changed at some point in time. So it's really, really difficult to make sense of the data in many cases. And a reason for this is that usually this data doesn't come from a single place. Usually it originates from multiple sources. Maybe a lot of people worked on this data over the time, then some people left or moved into a different position. Maybe there's different teams working on different use cases that together produce this data. Maybe that data is collected from different systems. I don't know, if you have maybe a video streaming service like Netflix or Amazon Video, they have lots of different devices with which their customers watch the videos. And then all these devices may measure things a bit different with different latency and things like that. And then you plug all of this together. Another problem in large organizations is that usually there's unfortunately not one single source of truth for the data. Usually there's several copies of the data, and often they are unfortunately inconsistent. That often happens for convenience. Maybe you copy the data to a system that is easier for you to work with. Maybe there's simply different technology stacks that need to work with the data. Maybe you only need some part of the data, and then over time that leads to a case where there are these multiple versions, and it might be difficult to figure out which version is the true version. It might even be difficult to figure out what the differences are between these versions. And in many cases, the data in the real world is also too large to be conveniently handled on a desktop machine. I mean, that's why we have this course. These are cases where you need systems like Spark or Hadoop or Flink or distributed databases to work with the data. And more often than not, the data in the real world is unfortunately also difficult to access. Maybe it's stored in a distributed file system in some partitioned way, and the data is compressed. So it might be easy to access it with one technology stack, but it might be difficult to access it with different technology stacks. So I hope this gives you some glimpse into how this problem could look like in the real world. And I mean, one reason for this is obviously you have very large organizations with different teams, different goals. But there's also some, let's say, historical reason for these changes in how data looks like, and also how the quality of the data is. And we talked about that a little bit when I told you the history, basically how the world moved from relational databases to these MapReduce systems. And we see it reflected here again. So in what I call the pre-internet era, I think the majority of data was collected in transactional relational databases. And that's still the case nowadays, but nowadays a lot of data is also collected in different data stores. And usually you have what's called an extract transform load process, an ETL process, that exports the data from somewhere to a data warehouse for analysis. And data warehouses are these analytical databases that Max talked about last week. And for that to happen, we need to have a model of the data and its schema before we actually collect it. So somebody needs to create the tables in the database, and how they are connected. And then there needs to be some process that basically takes the data, transforms it into the right format for this data model, the relational schema, and then puts it in there. Now, obviously, it's very good to do this. And for important data, like maybe financial data, that is what you're supposed to do, what people are doing. But with the arrival of the internet era, there was also a different way established of collecting data. I call it here collect first, analyze later. And in some sense, the internet gave rise to a vast amount of semi-structured data. I mean, just think of social media, for example. There's lots of comments everywhere, and images and pictures, and we have websites and discussion boards on websites. So there's all this data, but it's really, really difficult to get it into a relational schema. But there's a lot of value and information in the data. For example, I guess that a lot of very valuable information about products of e-commerce e-commerce applications is hidden in the reviews of the data. It's just very hard to extract it. So a lot of people might actually try to crawl product reviews from the internet, put it into a database, and then try to make sense of that. And there are also new data stores that have been established. Max talked about that briefly, that allow us to store very large data in a very simple way. So usually these are key value stores. So you define some kind of key for the data. And then the value that you store with this key is usually something that's unstructured or semi-structured, like a JSON document, for example, or just some text. And the advantage of these systems, and we heard about them, for example, Cassandra or Google Bigtable, is that they scale to very large data sets, and they were, for example, invented to hold copies of the web. Often they have a relaxed consistency, so you don't really do transactions over sets of records, often only do transactions on on a single record, and they enforce basically fewer modeling decisions at collection time. So you don't need to think as much about the data in order to collect it as you would have to do with a relational database. That makes it easier to collect data, but it also makes it more difficult to process the data later. And what you have to do in such use cases is you have to build a lot of the knowledge about the data into the actual application that works with it. So often that's called schema on read. So you have, let's say, JSON documents in some document database. And then it's difficult to figure out, okay, what actually is there in this JSON document? It's not like in a relational database where you can look at the schema. So the people who write applications that work with this data have to bake a lot of this knowledge into their applications. So in some sense, it's more difficult to write applications for this data. And I think this is mostly happening due to economic incentives. So we had this decreasing storing costs. So it doesn't cost, and we talked about that in our very first lecture. So it doesn't cost a lot to store data. So people also needed cheap systems that made it easy to collect a lot of data because it doesn't cost them a lot to buy these disks. And I think it's also due to the hype and promise of machine learning. So a lot of this data is actually collected in order to be somehow valuable as input to machine learning based applications. So what are the sources of error in the data? There are many, many different errors. In this talk, I'm mostly referring to a highly cited paper from Joe Hellerstein called Quantitative Data Cleaning for Large Databases from 10 years ago. And according to this paper, the main sources of error in data are these. So first of all, there's data entry errors, like typos in forms. I'm sure everybody, this happened to everyone already. You would type your data into some form and unfortunately you misspelled something. And then often it's really difficult to have a canonical spelling for some real world entity, especially for things like addresses and names. Often there's lots of different valid ways to write this address. Actually, coming from Germany, I was kind of very positively surprised about the Netherlands because they have this postcode and your house number, and that kind of identifies your street. So in most cases, you don't have to enter the street. I think that helps a lot with data quality. In the US where I lived, or in Germany, you have to type in the name of the street, and then often there's different ways to write the street or different abbreviations. So very easily you will have a lot of different spellings for the same place. Then there are measurement errors. So often you gather data by measuring something, and then of course it depends on where you measure something, and it also depends if there are some outside interferences in your measuring process. Then often it's not the raw data that is collected, but some kind of summary or distillation of the data. And it could be that the person who summarizes this data has some kind of bias, and that's reflected in the data. Or it could be that there's some difficult domain specific things, and the person who manages the data doesn't completely understand them. And I think that's one of the most important errors and also one of the most difficult problems to solve. There are so-called data integration errors. And that's often the case when we have different databases about the same thing. For example, let's say two companies decide to merge, then they might want to put together their customer databases. And then there might be different spellings, different semantics. So it becomes really, really difficult to put them together. And there might be duplicate entries or potential duplicate entries. Things might have been measured in different periods or different units. So in general, once you integrate data from different sources, there's always data quality problems. And it's really difficult to define data quality. And in the literature, there's usually four dimensions that people talk about. The first dimension is completeness. And that's the degree to which the data required to describe a real world object is available. That simply means how much of the data is missing. Then there is consistency with respect to the intra-relation constraints, the range of admissible values. That means very often certain attributes of our data, like, I don't know, let's say the age of a person has a data type, an interval, and an interval. If it's a categorical data like a zip code, then there's a set of allowed values. And it can be that we simply have some data entries that are outside of this admissible range. Then there is another form of consistency, which refers to the interrelation constraints. And that means the references to other data entries, what's usually known as foreign keys in databases. A simple way to think about this is, for example, if you have persons and addresses. So a person might have a zip code of their home address, and the zip code has to refer to a city or a district in the city. And this foreign key relationship here means that you cannot have non-existent zip codes. Like, you cannot have a person who has a zip code for a city that doesn't exist. That wouldn't make any sense. That would be a data quality problem. And finally, there's syntactic and semantic accuracy. And syntactic accuracy compares the representation of a value with this corresponding definition domain. Just means is the value syntactically correct for the domain of values that's allowed here. So let's say we have the color attribute of some entity, and the value in the database is blue, even though the actual product is red. Then blue is still syntactically accurate, because it means it's a value that would be okay for this column. It's just not the right value for this particular instance. And the semantic accuracy compares a value with its real world representation. Now we have a complete negative example. So for example, if we had the value XL for the color attribute, it would neither be syntactically nor semantically accurate for this product. And data quality is, I think, a very important and very unsolved problem. And there's different ways to address this problem. One maybe obvious way is data entry interface design. So that means we want to build forms for users to put in data that ideally only allow them to enter correct data. So there could be constraints on numeric values, maybe that you cannot enter a negative age. There's like referential integrity, that you cannot enter a non-existent zip code. But the problem is, there might be cases where you have to complete a form, and then some of these constraints are wrong, or they are simply not complete. And you have a case where maybe you can put something into that field, but this form forces you to put something into that field. And then, in a sense, what many people do, I've also been forced to do this, is you invent dirty data. Maybe you type in 000 or dash 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 for something that's not existing. And by that, basically destroy the purpose of these checks on the data entry form, because you introduced dirty values into the form because you have to submit it. Obviously, data quality is something that should also be addressed on an organizational level. So companies should streamline their processes for data collection and analysis, and they should also capture the lineage and metadata of their data. So lineage means basically also record the information of how certain data items have been produced, what their source is, how they have been processed, what the intermediate results are. And I think that's also an important area of research where we simply need much better automated solution to do this. And then there is what's called automated data auditing and data cleaning. And we will see some of the techniques for that area later. Where we try to come up with automated techniques, basically computer algorithms, to identify and in some cases even rectify data errors. And unfortunately, that's often really, really difficult, or maybe even impossible. So In practice, what often happens is that we need to do exploratory data analysis and data cleaning. So we have a human in the loop approach where we maybe have some automated techniques, but in the end, a human really needs to look at the data and decide whether something is correct or not. And often this is an iterative process. So maybe you've done this yourself already at some point in time. You look at data, you find that something wrong, you try to find all the instances, you try to repair them, and then you look for the next instances. In general, the techniques to do this automated identification depend on the type of data. So in this paper and also in our class, we look at three from four different types of data. So first of all, there's quantitative data, which means it's numbers, it's integers or floating point numbers, which can be in different shapes. We can have scalars, sets, tensors, time series. And there's lots of challenges there. One challenge is unit conversion. And that's especially difficult for volatile units like currency. Like for example, if you want to convert a dollar value into a euro value, then in some sense you have to know to what exact point in time this data refers to, because you need to know the actual conversion rate, otherwise you couldn't do the conversion. And the foundation of cleaning techniques there are so-called outlier detection algorithms. So in some sense, we want to identify numbers that are outside of a range that we consider normal or typical for the data. Then there's categorical data, which is usually names or codes to assign data into groups, like zip codes, for example. And usually there's no ordering or distance between the actual values. And very often the problems here actually stem from misspelling upon data entry. And the foundation of the cleaning techniques here is normalization or deduplication. So for example, think of addresses. There might be lots of different ways to spell a certain address. So ideally we would like to have some kind of algorithm that can give us one single canonical version of this address. Something that we don't do in this lecture, which is like a special case, are postal addresses, which are often entered as free text. And I'm not an expert there, but that's kind of a challenge in itself. And the last thing are identifiers or keys. So often we have special numbers that are identifiers for data objects, like product codes or phone numbers or social security numbers. And often they are used across different databases, and they can help us to identify like duplicates of the same identity or links between entities. And the challenge here is to detect the reuse of these identifiers across distinct objects. And the challenge here is that we want to ensure what's called referential integrity. So we want to make sure that there are no false links. Like I said before, we don't want to have a person with a zip code that doesn't exist in our database. And I think this is the last slide of this part. I want to stress this human loop part again. So if you read academic research about data cleaning, then often it has, in my experience, some unrealistic assumptions. So often there is the existence of some error detecting rules assumed, like there's some magical expert who can give you integrity constraints or what's called functional dependencies, which are basically rules how certain attributes dictate the values of other columns. And then in research, very often people start from this assumption. So we have all these rules that describe the quality of the data. And then the research focuses on efficient and accurate ways to apply the cleaning steps according to these rules. But in my experience, in many cases, you don't actually have these rules, and even the domain experts are not that sure about the data. So what I think personally is that there are these human in the loop solutions required, and where visualization and good user interfaces and an iterative process is very, very important. And here we have screenshots of two solutions for this. one solution that's on the bottom is called OpenRefine. That's an open source tool that I think was donated by Google. And I've personally used it for research data. It allows you to load a CSV file into this program and then, for example, use regex to explore the data, or it has some simple algorithms that we will see later to explore potential duplicates of strings and things like that. And a more commercial version, which is actually from the researcher who wrote this paper, Joe Hellerstein, or the company is founded by him, is Trifecta, which is a commercial solution that I think is now integrated in cloud services, which in some sense allows you to do the same thing, load your CSV data and then apply transformations to it. I think the cool thing about Trifecta is that it records these transformations, and it allows you to define some example transformations on a small part of the data, and then it can automatically apply these transformations that you define to large parts of the data. But I think the takeaway from this part of the lecture for you should be that data quality is an important, difficult, and in many senses, a very unsolved problem.